time. A few mistakes ago, I was in your sights. You got me alone. You found me. You found me. You found me. I guess you didn't care, and I guess I liked that. And when I fell hard, you took a step back. Without me. Without me. Without me. And he's long gone when he's next to me. And I realize the blame is on me. Never been till you put me down. Oh, I knew you were trouble when you walked in. So shame on me now. Blew me to places I've never been. Now I'm lying on the cold hard ground. Oh, oh, trouble, trouble, trouble. Oh, oh, trouble, trouble, trouble. No apologies. He'll never see you cry. Pretends he doesn't know that he's the reason why you're drowning. You're drowning. You're drowning. Now I heard you moved on from whispers on the street. A new notch in your belt is all I'll ever be. And now I see. Now I see. Now I see.
Hi everyone, morning. Welcome back to DataCom Lecture. So we are in week 6 already. Welcome back to another 8 o'clock lecture. Just right after your quiz 1. So I guess everyone here already done quiz 1, which maybe explain why today we only have 160 students left. Okay, I think this is quite normal. this is the trend of Datacom. Week 1, you have 200 students. After quiz 1, become 180. After midterm, 150. When you go to FA, it's about only half of the class left. So just want to thank everyone here today for joining me so early in the morning. Don't give up yet, you know. Some student is saying like, okay, the quiz is a little bit hard. So I just want to give you some context here. The average marks of your quiz 1 is about 7.5 to 8. So yeah, that is what your friend has been doing. If you think that I didn't do so well or the quiz is too hard, it might not be the quiz problem. Okay, sometimes it might be you. You might have to study a little bit harder. Okay, yeah, I think it's like 7.5, yeah, it's correct. So it's even like the same as the economy this day. When everyone say MCO, still MCO until today, then everyone no money. But I go online, Apple, and check, all iPad is out of stock. Then right now, IKEA is having sales. Yeah, actually it's true, right? IKEA is having an IKEA sales right now. I go to check, everything is out of stock. So actually, I think the economy, no problem. The problem is me. No money to buy anything. Yeah, it's normal one. These students, they are still taking Datacom, but they will appear only in the midterm test. I think you never have this kind of experience yet, right? So let me tell you, like in the physical class, first class, okay, you will see the lecture hall is crowded, no seat. Then everyone want to go early to fight for the front row seat, VIP seat. I don't know why some students like to sit in the first row. Maybe because they want the attention of the lecturer or what, I don't know lah. Then after a few weeks, half of the class is gone. Then in the midterm test only, a student come back. So sometimes I even see people like, hey, who are you? Are you in my class? I see them in for the first time when they take the quiz. Okay, so today is a new start. If you think previously it's too hard, today is a new start. Okay, we will be learning this thing called network routing. So it is new. We have never talked about network routing before. And this is a really, really important concept in computer networking that allowed the whole internet to work. Okay, now, so you don't have to wait until the next semester and then you say new tribe, new sem, new me. No need. This class is a new sem, new me, okay? Because this one is totally something new. So I hope everyone by the end of the class, you will be able to know how to do routing on Cisco routers, and you're very clear about what is routing, what routing is about, and why we even need to do routing in the first place. Okay, so yeah, to do so in this class, you will need two things. First one is the lecture slide, of course. This is again another class that you need to have slides. Not every class we need, but this one we need. And then you will have one PKT file that comes with this. Now, I realized that the PKT file that you can find on the chat down in the video descriptions down below is not compatible with the versions that you have. So don't worry. Right now, what we'll do is I'll just explain the concept. And then by the end of the class, I'll do a short demo for you on how we actually configure routing. And after the stream, upload another file which I think will be compatible with your versions, and then only you try to practice that on your own. Okay, so if you haven't get this lecture slide open, please open this one, because I think there is a lot of notes that you will take today as I explain the concept of network routing. Okay, so yeah, so far until now, we are in week 6. We learned so many about Datacom and networking already. So I think by now everyone here can, you already know what is IP address, what is MAC address, what is port number, we have static IP, dynamic IP. All of you here should be able to configure a routers already. That's great. But so far, okay, so far, everything that we have talked about until today, this class, is about a local area network. So it's about your own LAN, okay? Now we have never ever talked about how do we connect different networks together yet, because all the while the scope is about our own network only. So today is different. Today we want to go to the internet. We don't want to stay at our home anymore because we know lockdown is just a prank. Every time you lock down, the number keep going up. So this time, today, we want to get out. We want to get away from your own local area network. So essentially, what it means is we want to see how we can connect many LANs together, like how can I make LAN 1 to talk to LAN 2, LAN 2 to talk to LAN 3, and so on. And to do so, we need a router. So today, most of the things that we are going to talk about will be on how we do certain things on a router to connect many networks together. All right, so let's talk about when do we need to build routing first. Okay, so far when we learn datacom, we have seen something like this. We already know what is a router. We also know that every time you connect a new cable to a router, you build a new network. So in this example here, I have two networks. Alright, now this class, we want to go further. We want to see how we can connect network that is on another router. So something like this. Okay, so we want to go to the internet already. It is no longer on our own network. Now, of course, we have seen this example. I don't think you will get someone, you will see anyone, okay, I buy a router now, and then I build one network, okay? Now, this is not how we use router, because we all know router is really expensive network device. And if you just want to have one local area network, then why do you even buy a router? You can just go and get a switch or a hub, and you will have your own net, okay? It's like you buy an iPad. Because you are so rich, you buy an iPad, and then you just use the iPad as the alarm clock. You put alarm, open the clock, put it on your bed, on the table next to your bed. So the whole iPad Pro 3000 is just to be your alarm clock. Nobody do that, okay? So we all know the reason you have router is in the first place you want to build multiple network. Okay, now today we want to see what if we want to go to another network. So all the while, we have been seeing something like this, LAN 1 going to LAN 2, right? So you can have some PC inside this network that is talking to each other. So last week, in your lab 2, you learned how to configure IP address on router. Now, I think everyone here already know about how to do this. And then it just worked. Like magic, it just worked. By the end of the lab, you take the PC and then you try to ping each other, and then you can see if you have set everything correctly, you're supposed to be able to ping. Now, think about this. We have never even talked about the word routing. Okay? That is because we don't have to do routing all the time. So when we learn about network routing, the very first thing that you want to know is, do I even need to do routing? It's not like, okay, I want to build routing because it is cool. Because I have a mechanical keyboard and I just like to type command, or because it's datacom, then I want to pass the exam, so I learn routing. No, the reason is because you do routing is because you want to connect multiple remote networks together. So this is how we decide how we should do routing, or we shouldn't even have to think about routing. Okay, so I have one router here, and again, this is the same example here. I have one network on the right and one network on the left. Okay, so let's say I have something like this. Now, next thing, we want to talk about this thing called a directly connected network. So this is a new concept that I think you see this for the first time, which is called a directly connected network. Or I think in the previous class, we call this the closed network. So they are actually the same thing here. Okay, so what do we mean by a directly connected network? In this case, if I take LAN 1 as example, if LAN 1 is connected right now to router 1, and then I have LAN 2 here, LAN 2 is also connected directly to router 1. So in this case, we can say that, okay, yeah, LAN 1 and LAN 2, they are both connected to the same router. In this case, we can say that LAN 1 is directly connected to LAN 2. Okay, so this is what we mean by directly connected network. If the network they are connected to the same router, they are called as directly connected. So if I have another example like this, I have one more network here on the top, then I add one more cable, I put one more network here, LAN 3. Now in this case, we can say that LAN 1 is directly connected to LAN 3 also, because again, they are all connected to the same router 1. So as a summary here, LAN 1, in this case, LAN 1 is directly connected to LAN 2 and also LAN 3. So that is directly connected. So what about not directly connected? So the better way to say this is a remote network. Okay, so a remote network means you are not directly connected. Okay, so let's say if I have another router here. Okay, before I do that, just want to make this clear that now when the network are directly connected, so LAN 1 and LAN 2 and LAN 3, there is no need for you to do routing. No need. Okay? So first thing is, when I ask you the question, do you need to do routing? You have to look at two things. The first thing is how many routers. So let me write this down here for you. Like, how many routers you have. And then, are the networks directly connected to each other? So these are the two questions that you want to answer. Now, if you look at this first example here, if there is only one router, okay, immediately, you see, no need to do routing. If one router, no routing. If you have two or more router, then yes, you might have to think, maybe I need to do routing. It's not definitely yet, but maybe, very likely, I will have to do routing if there are two or more routers. Okay, now, the second question is, you have to answer this, are they directly connected? So again, let's come back to this concept of remote network. Now, if I have a router like this, and then now I connect this router one to another router two. Okay, so this is router two, and I build network on router two this time. So a green color network pop up here, router two, and this I call this a LAN 4. Now in this case, we say that LAN 1 is not directly connected to LAN 4. The reason is because now you see the router that they are connected to are different. Router 1, LAN 1 connected to router 1. So what router is LAN 4 connected to? LAN 4 is here. It is connected to router 2. So from here we can see they are actually not connecting to the same router. So they are not directly connected. In this case, we say that LAN 1 and LAN 4, they are remote network. So there are two concepts. Either you are connected directly or you are not connected directly. Okay. Now, this concept is very important as we move on later, so that later when we try to learn how to set routing, then you will have to be able to identify whether they are directly connected or not. Okay. So for this class, I know 8 in the morning, this is not the right time for us to tell you so much about the theory, but anyway, we have to learn the theory part first. So in the first half hour or maybe 1 hour, show you all the concepts that you might need to learn. And then the second part, I will show you how to configure routing, the real stuff, okay? In Datacom, it's always half-half. We have theory and practical. We don't want to have train you to be very good in theory, like, wow, I'm so good. You know, all the boss now, all the entrepreneur, some people like to call themselves entrepreneur so that it make the profile look more atas. But what they really do is just open a Shopee shop and then they call themselves entrepreneur. Those kind of entrepreneur, they like to use the term machine learning, deep learning, data science, big data in their resume. And then everyone think, wow, this guy knows so much. But when you ask them to do, they don't know what is machine learning. They put it there because the word sound atas only. So in Datacom, I don't want you to be like that. Later you are so good, then the boss passed a router to you. Oh no, you have to Google already. So yeah, half-half, okay? That's great. Now we go back to your slides. We have a few routing rules that we will go through now. Now don't worry, it is not as many as the rules that we see in the subnet rules. Just maybe 3 to 4 rules that are the important one. And once you understand those rules, we can start to do routing. Now I need you to skip the slide first. We want to go to the subnet rules first before we come back to the previous slides. And today we will start with IP routing rules number 1. Okay, so this is what I just explained earlier. The very first thing about routing is you have to decide, do I even need to think about routing? So the way you do this is you check the two things that I said earlier. If there is one router or more, if there are two or more routers, then yes, this is when you might need to do routing. And also the next thing is you have to see whether they are directly connected. So perhaps we can add here the source and destination network. We want to check if they are directly connected. So these are the two things that you want to look for when you decide whether you want to do routing or not. Okay, now in this example here, we can look at, we will use this example to see whether you need to do routing. So first thing, you will have to be able to know how many network I have here. And this is something that we have learned way back where we try to see what is the LAN boundaries. Okay, so in this case, I will start to draw the boundaries of each LAN for you. We have one here on the left. We have the second network here. And we have the third network here. So in this diagram here, we have three network. Now, let's say if I want to be allowed this PC0 here to talk to PC2. So let's say we want PC0 to ping to PC2. So here is PC2 and ping. Now, the question is, do we need routing? If you don't set routing, you will try to ping like this. Okay, I can cheat a little bit. Let me tell you that it is really cannot. Because they are not directly connected. Okay, so every time you want to go to a remote network or the destination that is not connected to the same router, you need to set routing. So in this case, the answer is yes. I will need to set routing if you want PC0 to talk to PC2. Okay, now, next question. If I want PC0 to talk to PC1, do I need to set routing or not? Let me know on the YouTube chat, yes or no, Y or N. Correct. Red Bean, you are a good. Red Bean say no. That is correct. Okay. So I guess you guys actually get it now. PC0 and 1 no need because they are in the same network. So let me visualize this for you. If you try to use PC0 and ping to PC1, the packet will only go to the switch. We have learned this, so this is just a reminder. Because if you're in the same LAN, the packet will never ever go to the router. So this is how the packet will travel. Just like that. Okay? Now if you send from PC0 to PC2, you want to go to a different network that is not in the same LAN, then you need to go to the router. Okay, now in this class, we have something new. After go to the router, because it is not the same router here, we need to set routing here. I'll show you how to set routing in a while. Okay, now let's go to rules number 2. There are 2 types of routing. So we have a static routing and a dynamic routing. So this is similar to what we have earlier when we learned about IP address. We also have IP, static IP, and dynamic IP. So Datacom, I think you can get the picture now. It's almost about the same thing, although it is for a new concept. So static IP means you have to manually configure the IP on every machine. Dynamic IP means free and easy, no need. A server will be the guy who gives IP to everyone. So it's very similar to routing. In a static routing, you are the one who have to manually configure all the routes from one network to the other network. Now, if you do a dynamic routing, it is automatic, means that you don't have to tell the router how to get from place A to B to C. Okay, it is automatically done by the router itself. So they will find out somehow, they will find a way to get from one place to another, one network to another. So that is dynamic routing. Now, of course, if I just stop there, then it sounds a bit biased. Like, then why would anyone even want to learn static routing, right? If dynamic is so auto. Nobody is driving a manual car anymore here, right? Anyone still driving a manual car? I think everyone's car is auto mode now. But why we still have static route? Okay, now, I want this to be clear. In networking, it doesn't mean that dynamic is always better. In some cases, static route will be a better choice than a dynamic route. So now, I'm going to explain how they are different from each other, and then when you should be using a static route, and when you should be using a dynamic route. Okay? Oh, we still got so many manual kaki. These are the people who drive kanja, but then they put sticker and then they put F1 or something. Okay, guys, so now let's look at this table here. In a static route, static route is manually configured by the admin. So you can guess from the name, static means that the admin has to do all of the job. Okay, so which means the admin will have to go to the router and then he will have to tell the router, okay, to get from IKEA to from Gampa to IKEA, you have to take the ETS train and then you go to KL Central, and in KL Central you change to the MRT line and then you stop at Damansara station. So these are routing. Routing is very similar to your Google Map, how you get from one place to another place. Okay, now, but in Google Map, who tell you how to get to one place to another place? Google. Google has a machine learning AI built in on map that can tell you how to get from A to B. Now, in static route, you are the one who do that. Okay? Now, the problem with static route is this. If that is a topology change, okay, then you need to update the static route manually. Okay, now this is the problem here. Actually, setting a static routing and a dynamic routing on a router, if you ask me, I think they are about the same. It takes about the same amount of time, okay? But the problem actually happens. You can see a difference when something changed in the network. Now, you see, you are the one who have to update. So let me give you one example here. Oh, before that, let me finish all the wording here and then I give you one example. Okay, now, in a dynamic route, the router get the information from other routers. So as you can see here, now the admin don't have to teach the router how to get from A to B anymore. Because router, they are actually learning from each other. So it's like this. Even if you talk about maps, the apps, okay, on the store right now, we have so many kind of apps. You have Apple Map, you have Google Maps, you have Waze. I think some of you are using Waze. Most of you are using Waze. Now, they are different in many ways. Sometimes some people might prefer Waze because Waze is better in finding shortcuts. Like they know all the taman-taman route that nobody ever go there, but somehow they know how to show you that way. Now Google Map is better in terms of maybe they can tell you there are routes. The routes have toll. So if you want to avoid certain payment, then you want to use another route. Now Apple Map, I don't want to comment too much about Apple Map. Don't use Apple Map in Gampa because we have too many lakes here. So if you use Apple Map in Gampa, you will end up in one of the lakes. So yeah, what I'm telling you is every map is different. So even for routers are different. So what I mean here is that for this kind of routers, the way they know, like, okay, my router and your router, they know different things. Like, let's say my router, he might know how to get from Gampa to Sungai Long. Your router will not. But your router might know some area or some routes that I do not know. So what router do to each other is they are learning. So if you know something that I don't know, then okay, I'm going to learn from you. And I'm sure you know you do not know something that I know. So you can learn from me. Router is like that. They will learn from each other. This is what it means by this sentence here. They will get the route from other router. And once they learn, they know how what you know, then they know how to get to the places that only you know of in the first place. So these are how router learn in dynamic routing. Okay, now this is the best part. In a dynamic routing, okay, when the topology change, it updates automatically. So this is the best part here. Like if you set dynamic routing for the first time, actually your job is done. Then you can just pack and go home, celebrate Chinese New Year. Okay, if you do a static routing, after you set, then you have to take the, what they call this, the hu tao. Hu tao is in Hokkien. I do not know what it's called in Chinese or English. You have to stick that one that you pray, the sticker, put it on the router, and then you pray, please don't break down, don't break down. Only you can go back for Chinese New Year. So static route is a bit more troublesome in terms of route updates, alright? Okay, so now I'll give you one example to visualize the difference here. So let's say if I have, okay, what is network topology? Network topology is what I'm drawing. All the while when I draw something like this, okay, you have routers, you have network. These are called network topology, okay? Now let's say if I have one PC here, it is connected to three routers. So router 1, router 2, router 3, and then connect in the end is a PC 2. So we have two end devices connected to each other here. Okay, now, again, if you remember what I said in lecture 1 about internet. So the whole internet, if you remember, is a collection of routers. So internet is just a lot of routers connected, interconnected together. So let's say you might not really see that unless you work for ISP, because what we normally see is our own network. So we don't see how does the internet look like, but in the core network, or we call this the ISP network, there are a lot of routers, meaning that actually for you to get from one network to another network, there are more than one ways, okay? Even like let's say now, I'm in Gampa. For me to get from Gampa to IKEA in Damansara KL, because they're having a sales, okay, I have so many options. Either I can drive to the ETS station here, the KTM station, I take ETS to KL Central, and then I change to MRT. Or I can just drive, and then I exit from this Tapato, and then I enter the Damansara to in KL. Or if I reach, I can just drive to Ipoh, and then I take a flight, and then I land in KLIA. Then I take a Grab car to IKEA. Yeah, there are so many ways, okay? Which you can already think like some way doesn't even make sense. So yeah, that's correct. So on the network is the same. You have many routers connected together. This is like how the internet looks like, okay? It can even be like this. Or it can even be like this. So internet, in fact, they look quite ugly if you really want to draw them, because there are just many, many routers connected together. Now, what it means for us is for me to get from one place to another place, I have more than one options. And technically, this is called routes. Routes means that the path that you can take to get from a source network to a destination network. Okay, now in this example here, I will now show you why you need a static route and then why you need a dynamic route. Okay, now if I configure a static route, okay, and then I say PC1, if you want to go to PC2, you have to pass your network to router 1, then router 1 will pass to router 2, and router 2 will pass to router 3. So you see, I'm talking about passing. So the way routing works is like I pass your data or your packet forwards from one router to another router. So you can imagine this like, let's say today you are in LDK, and then you see like, okay, next to you, maybe next, not immediately next to you, a few tables away, there is a pretty girl sitting there. Okay, so you want to know the girl, so you write a love letter, you pass the love letter to her. So you cannot just throw it to her one, because it's too far. If you throw, the paper will not land in her desk. So you want to pass this love letter that you write, hello, can I have your IG? Then you pass the paper to the guy next to you, and then the guy next to you will pass it further down to the next guy until finally this paper that you write reach her, right? So router is like that. One data you will keep on passing from one router to another router. Okay, now this passing, this action is called forwarding. So we call this packet forwarding. When you get the data, what router do is like, router only has one job, to pass the data forward. Okay, so in this case, I hope you guys get the concept here. This is called packet forwarding. Now, before I continue with this example, I want to visualize more about what happened in the router first. So in a router, there can be many interfaces. Okay, so this is a router. Okay, so let's say I have FA00, FA01. So I have four interfaces in this example here. FA11, FA10. Now, let's say one day, one packet get into this router from here. Okay, so when the packet is in a router, what a router does is, like again, one job, he have to think how to send this packet forward. And by that, it means I have three other exit interface, okay? How do I send? Should I send this here so that it can finally reaches the final destination? Or should I send it here? Then it can go until final destination. Or should I send it here? Okay, so as you can see, a router job is like, for me, is what do I have to eat later for lunch? Router is, which interface should I pass the packet to so that this packet can finally reach the destination network. So this is the only job router have, okay, to find the right interface. Now, of course, for me to say this is easy. As you see later, it's actually there are a lot more things that happen behind it, okay? Now, come back to this example. If you already know how does the forwarding works, which is what I have just shown you, so let's talk about how static route is different from dynamic route. Now I set a static route and then I tell him to go from PC1 to PC2, you need to pass this route. So we call this a route. Router 1 to router 2 to router 3. Okay? Now this is great. This is great. If everything is fine, then this is great. Then the internet is going to work. But let's say something bad happens. Suddenly the website cannot be displayed. So we can assume something like something bad happened in the network. For example, this cable is the Godzilla bite this cable. Then this cable is broken. Then suddenly no internet because now this path is broken. So you cannot go to the router 3. Things like that happen all the time, okay, on the internet. Just that as end user, we do not notice them so often. Okay, now, if this happened, then, like I say, your destination will be unreachable because now PC1 can no longer reach to PC2 because one of the cable is broken. So in the internet, when we design the internet, we cannot just design like that one. We have to make sure we have a backup path. For example, I should have a few more routers like this connected to PC2. So I can have router 4 and router 5. Okay, we call this redundancy. This is a very important concept in computer networking because like I say, we already expected bad thing is going to happen. So if we only have one way from one side to another side, sure one day something is going to stop working. So you need to have redundancy, a backup path. Now if you set a static route like what I said earlier, even with a backup path available, you know that if this cable is broken now, we have another way. We can just take this way. And then still I can get to PC2, correct? That's why we have a backup path 4. But if you set a static route, it is not going to work. Because static route means that if you tell the router, you go router 1, router 2 to router 3, he will forever, doesn't matter what you do, follow that path. Even though the path is no longer working. That is static route, which means that if you want PC1 to now take the alternate path, the yellow one, to get to PC2, you have to go back to the router, each of them, and then you configure the new routes. Then you have to tell the router, hey routers, the earlier path is no longer working. So now you have to change the path to router 1, to router 4, and to router 5. And then to router, And then to router 3. Wait, let me move this. Okay, so this is the new static route. Later on, we will also learn how to set this. Okay, now for the concept, this is what happened. A static route is a bit troublesome if something changed in the network. We call this a topology change. Topology change means that some link is broken, you will need to have a new way to get to the destination. Alright, now you see, if this is a dynamic route instead of a static route, if I set a dynamic route, we actually have less of this problem. So if this is a dynamic route, same network, okay, so same thing happened. We have this network here, but instead of setting static route, now I go to each of these routers and I configure a dynamic route, and the original path, let's say, is the green color one. Okay, now again, this link is broken. Okay, we know that now you will have to take the alternate path. In this case, when this happens, the router automatically detects. So at this place, it will auto-detect a link failure. So link failure means some link is down. Immediately, he will try to find another way by doing a routing table updates. After the updates, he will know what is the next path that can bring me to the destination without needing you to do anything at all. And then immediately, the packet will now take the new path. So two things happen. First, I detect a link failure. Second, I find a new link for you, a new route for you. So this is the convenience that comes with dynamic routes. We don't even have to worry like one day how many Godzilla, how many Alpha is trying to bite our undersea cable. We don't care because we know, we trust routers that they will always find a way. Okay? Sounds like a fairy tale story when I say it that way. Okay, so yeah, that is dynamic route. But then, if it is so good, why do people still use static route? Okay, I have to be honest, I don't want to be biased. Then you think like dynamic route is always the best. Actually, it's not. Okay, you see, I give you another example. If I only have very simple topology, say I have two routers only, router 1 and router 2. Okay, and then again, the same two PC connected. We know you need to set routing because there are already two or more routers. Okay, now, in this case, if I ask you, should you do a dynamic routing or static routing? The answer is actually a static routing. It's the preferred option. This is better in this case. So, we can say that in a simple topology, simple means that you don't have that many routers, static routing is actually better. That is because with static routing, you have better network performance. So when I say performance, I mean, what do I mean is that you don't have to waste so much traffic for the routers to do dynamic routing. So this is what happened. If you do a static routing, the router don't have to talk to each other. They are classmates, like you and your online friend now, but you don't talk to each other unless it is necessary, unless assignment due date is tomorrow. Then you start to ask your friend, hey, send me your part. So static routing is like that. Routers do not talk to each other one for the routing tables update. Okay, so you see, if that is the case, we don't put extra traffic onto the network. But you do a dynamic routing, then you have this thing called a routing table updates. Okay, now the reason how routers will be able to tell you to get from A to B, you take this route, or to get to A to C, you take this route, is because in all the routers, we have this thing called a routing table. This is the main table in a router that tells you how to get from point A to point B. Alright? So, this guy is offended again. Don't find him for assignment member. Okay, so you see, this routing table updates means every time, we call this a periodic update, so interval. You can think like every routers, you have a routing table. So let me call this RT, RT1, RT2, okay? Now every 10 seconds or 15 seconds or 30 seconds, what router do is they will change their table. So router 1 will change, will pass his table to router 2. Router 2 will also pass his table to router 1. And this is what I mean by router learn from each other. They are exchanging their routing tables so that they know what you know, and then they learn from you. So this is the detail of this is not part of DataCom. So you just have to know the overview of this thing. Now, when this happens, this one is actually data. These are data. And when you send data in the network, you are using the network bandwidth. Okay? Which means that if you have a lot of routers, most, like a large portion of the network bandwidth or the capacity that you have on the link will be used by routers to exchange all these tables, which is why it can actually add burden to the network. So that's why I say static routing is better than dynamic routing if you have simple network, because then you can just configure this on your own instead of you want router to change the table so frequently and then just eat up your bandwidth for these kind of reasons. Okay, so it is really up to you, like if you want to save bandwidth or you want to have less work. Alright, so these are the difference between a static routing and a dynamic routing. So yeah, okay, if you're okay with principle 2, we go back to your slides now. Okay, now I'll show you one more example on routing table. So now we'll go back to the earlier slides here. And now I'll show you what is a routing table and what do we have inside a routing table. Okay, so what's a route? Now, so far until now, we have been talking about routing for about 1 hour already. So you see some of the example that I give you, like from to get from point A to point B, and then I draw how to go there. So that whole thing is called a route. Okay, so route simply means a path for you to get from a source network to a destination network. So for example, something more relatable, if you are watching this video right now, I do not know whether you are watching this from your bed or you are sitting in front of the machines now. The reason you see this video is because here, when I'm streaming, I'm uploading my data to YouTube server, which I think is somewhere in Cyberjaya. Okay, Google actually have our own Google Malaysia. So our data center is in Cyberjaya, I think, if I'm not wrong. Most of the servers is in Cyberjaya, in fact. So my data is streamed from Kampa routers to the server in Cyberjaya, and when you watch this video, you're actually getting the data from the server from Cyberjaya to whatever locations that you are currently streaming from right now. So that is how the internet works. And you see, from Kampa to Cyberjaya, it's not directly Kampa to Cyberjaya one. I have to go through many routers. Kampa maybe need to go to Tapa router. Then Tapa go to Rawang router. Then Rawang go to Cyberjaya. So there are many routers in between. We call these routes. Okay? Now, how all these things work is because router got routing table. So now we're going to see what is a routing table. This part is really important. I'll try to explain this example. So what you want to get from this slide is, after this slide, you should know, like very, very sure, what is inside a routing table and then how do you read the routing table. Okay? Now, before I start, I just want to give you a heads up. Like, this part can be very confusing for some of you because this is the first time you see this. Now, if it is confusing, do not give up yet, okay? I think most of the time when I stop here, after this one, I'll give you a 10-minute break. But after this slide, most people don't come back anymore because some of you might not get the idea here. So I will try to go slow. If you cannot, that is fine. That is fine. Okay, I'm not saying this to make you feel good, that's fine. Because later on, you see, in the slide here, I have another example for you. So we have a few examples. Okay, now we start with the first example on the routing table. Okay, so to explain this, I'll hide myself a while so that you can focus on the slide instead of my handsome face. So I have three routers here, router A, router B, and router C. okay? They are all connected together through just a single connection. And you can see there are three tables. So these are called routing tables. So for the left one, these are the router A routing table. This is router B routing table. And then this is router C routing table. So each router will have your own routing table. Now, next. For this example, I will just show you router B, okay? So I will use router B as the example, but the same logic will later apply to router A and router C. Alright? Now what we want to learn is we want to now know what is inside a routing table. So I don't want you to look at the other side, like just look at this table here, okay? This table. This is for router B. Okay, now in routing table, there are three main components. Of course, there are more things. But the three main components here is the destination network, the next hop address, and the interface. Okay, now this destination means the destination network ID, which means this is the network address of the places that you want to go to. For example, a more relatable example, if I want to go to IKEA, I can choose to go to IKEA Damansara or IKEA Tebrau or IKEA Cheras or IKEA Batu Kawan. So I can, this one here is where you put all the destination. Okay, these are the destination network or Yuta Gampa, Yuta Sungai Long, the places that you want to go to. Now the next part is the next hop IP. This next hop IP is a IP address of a router, okay, and this is the router that is next to you that is actually helping you to pass the data forward. Okay, now I will show you more example on this in a while, but as of now you should think next hop router is just a router that is helping you to get to the next router along the way until you finally reaches the destination. All right Now, interface is just the X interface. So this one, I'll just explain using the diagram in a while. So again, three components. You have network, you have next hop, and you have interface. Now, next thing is you want to see how I get all this value here. Okay, let's start with destination network first. Now, every routing table, you will need to have this network because that is the whole point of routers, right? How to get to certain places. Alright, so over here I have four lines. Why I have four networks is because in this example here, I have four LAN. So you see, if I start from left to right, now let me draw the LAN boundaries for you. I have one network here, second network, third network, and this is the fourth network. So 1, 2, 3, 4, which is why here you see I have four lines. Line 1, line 2, line 3, and line 4. So, I think it's clear, like, now you need to know first thing, how many routes do I have here? Each of these things is called a routes, okay? This thing here, we call this a routes. So, how many routes do you have in the routing table actually depends on the topology that you have. So, in the very simple example that we have here, because I have 4 networks on the topology, that is why I have 4 rows here, and each row represents how to get to one network. Alright, so this is the first thing. So as you can see here, we can also see the value here. So on the leftmost network is 10.3.1.0. So you see, this is the network here, 10.3.1.0. Okay, now the next network here is 10.1.2.0. So this one here, 10.1.2.0. If you look at the routing table, it's here, 10.2.1.0 is here, this one. Then you see the third network here is 10.2.1.0, this one. And then the last network is 10.4.1.0, this one. So every network on the topology, you will have one route to that network, okay? So again, here we have four networks, so four routes. Okay, now the second column. Second column is a little bit challenging here. So let's look at what is the next hop. Okay, again, next hop simply means the next router. So I write this for you. Next hop means in our language, the next router, okay, that forward your data. So over here, later I explain the explanation a bit. So the next part is you want to use the interface IP of this router that is closest to your original router. So there are two things that we want to take care for the next hop. So first thing is you will have to find who is your next router. Okay, sometimes it is yourself in some special case. After you find out who is your next router, the next thing you want to do is you have to see which interface on the router that is the next hop. Okay, so next hop means one interface on the next router. Now, for this example here, we can start with the first network. So first destination network is 10.1.2.0. Okay, so again, we are looking at router B. So everything that we say from here onwards is from the point of view of router B. Okay, so where is 1.2.0? Here. So for router B to go to 10.1.2.0, in fact, we already see, this is a directly connected network. Okay, now if it is a directly connected network, you don't have to write the next hop IP at all. So actually the right answer here, okay, is NA. You don't have to have a next hop because next hop is yourself. Alright, now if you have this kind of questions in the exam and you answer in this way, this is correct and you save a lot of time. Now, if you want to know why we put this IP here, I can also show you lah. Okay, so you see, this router B go there, the packet, okay, this is the packet, I will draw in red color. Go from this router, go here, go into this network. Okay, so who is the next hop? In this case, the next hop router is yourself. So not other router. You are the next hop yourself. So router B. After that, you have to see on router B, there are two interfaces. There are 1.2 here and 1.0 here. So you have to pick between them, pick one. In this case, I'll pick 2 because it is the interface that goes to this network. 1 go to this network, correct? So the right interface is this 2. Now once I know the interface here, then I can find the full IP address. So what is the full IP address? This interface belongs to this network. Okay, this is the network ID, 10.1.2.0. So the full IP is 10.1.2.2 because here is a .2 which is given to you. Okay, so this is .2, which is why you see here the next hop IP is 10.1.2.2. So this is how I get the next hop IP. Okay, but this is not a really good example because they are already in fact directly connected. Okay, so how about the interface? Let's talk about the interface now. This E0. This E0 means the exit interface, okay, that the router should forward this packet to in order to get to a certain place. So this E0 comes from here. The same example here, the packet go out from this interface, which I now color in red color. Can you see that? Which is why here is E0. Okay, so that is the first example. If you cannot get it, it's still normal. You are still normal. If you can get it, you are not normal because you are a special child. Your mother should be proud. Okay, now I give you the next example. We move on to the next network. Okay, we do this slowly, don't worry. Now I'm in the second network, 10.2.1.0. So for router B to go here, so this is 10.2.1.0. For me to go to this network, the data have to go from my router here, okay, and then get here. Now, in this case, who is my next hop router? Again, it is myself because I'm not asking any other router to help me. Okay, so this is the network here. So I know that now I am the next hop router. I have two interfaces. I have to pick one now. I want to pick the one that is closest to the, is like how you pass the data forward to get to destination. So here is like this. You want to pick this dot one. Okay, now after that, you see this whole network. The network address is 10.2.1.0. So the full router IP for this interface is 10.2.1.1. Because here is dot one, so I get a dot one here. And that is why we have 10.1. Oh, this is something wrong with the answer. This should be, okay, I want you to change this one. It should be 10.2.1.1. So this is not correct. Oh, why nobody tell me earlier? Okay, so this is the next hop IP. Okay, now for the exit interface is E1. Who make this slide? I have a confession to make. Write this on UC. I'm not the one who make this slide. Okay, so the exit interface should be E1 here, which is this interface here. Okay. Now, let's go to the third example. Well, luckily, I show you this example. Otherwise, everyone is confused. Okay, now let's go to the third network. So how to get to 10.3.1.0? So again, I'm router B. I'm trying to get to 10.3.1.0 here. Okay, now this time, we need to go through router A. Router B need to send to router A to get here. So we have to go through one router. This is not directly connected anymore. Okay, so this example, the data will come here, go here. So here, the next router is not yourself. The next router is this guy. This is the next hop router. Okay, so the next thing you want to do is you have to choose the next hop interface. Okay, so here you have, of course, two options. Okay, this one it doesn't show you lah. There is supposed to be two IP here. So you want to pick which one? This one or this one? The one on the left or the one on the right? The trick is always choose the interface that is closest to you. Closest mean that this one and this one, you compare, this one is closer to your own router. So this is the right interface. Okay? Now, after that, you know this already, you want to find the full IP address. This is the network, 10.1.2.1. So the full IP is 10.1.2.1. The network is 10.2.0, so this is 2.1. This is the next hop IP, 10.1.2.1. So this is how I get this next hop IP here. Alright, now the exit interface is still the same, E0 here. So, for exit interface, actually quite clear cut. Just pick the interface on the router, on your own router. Okay, cool. Chiumin say dot one. At least one people is still alive. For me, it's very easy. We have 200 students here. If one student say he understand, that is great. That is great. More than enough. Then I will celebrate later. Okay, guys, we go to the last network already. And then it's time for coffee. So I want to go to 10.4.1.0 now. Okay, so here, 10.4.1.0 is here. I'm again router B, I'm trying to get here. Okay, so what do I have in my routing table is of course 4.0, this is where I want to go to, and then my next hop IP. So now I will see what is the next hop IP. So over here, the data will go from router B, go to router C. So the next hop router is router C. Okay, now on router C, I have two interfaces. I got here and here. Should I choose the left one or the right one? The answer is here, dot two, because this is the interface closer to your original source router. Okay, now this is the network. So if 10.2.1.0, if I have the host IP of 2.2, then it's 2.1.2. So this is my IP, which is why you see here the next hop is 10.2.1.2. And again, the exit interface is the interface on your own router, but that direction. So in this case, this is the exit interface E1 here. So yeah, the E1 is the exit closest to the source. E1 is your own interface, okay, your own router interface that you will send the packet out where you want to exit. Like if you drive on the highway, which toll you want to exit? Should you exit Batu Kawan or Tambun or BM? Okay, this is the exit interface. Okay, so now we have explained all these four network, and you already see what is in the routing table. You also already see how I get all this value. I know you need a bit of time, so now I'll give you 10 minutes, all right, to go through this, try to catch up until here. And when we come back, I'll show you how this thing looks like in the real routing table, the real thing looks like. And then we'll go on to the hands-on part where I will show you how we configure all these things. Okay, so I'll see you back in 10 minutes.
And I'll write your name. Boys only want love if it's torture. Don't say I didn't, say I didn't.
Come on!
Okay guys, so welcome back to the second part here, and right now I think some of you already managed to spot some errors in the routing table, which is cool. Like this slide has been used for 4 years, but no one ever tell me something is wrong until today I find out. Okay, and you find out. So the next part is we're going to look at the real routing table and see how it really looks like inside a router, and then I'll show you how to configure a static routing, dynamic routing. Then lastly, we'll talk about what is this thing called a default route. So let's get back to your slides now, and then we want to look at the next page next to this one. So why are you you are 02 people, but why you listen to my father's song? Okay, so yeah, this slide, this is the slide next to the table that we used earlier. And this is a real routing table. This is how it really looks like. So routing table you see here earlier is like this. Wow, so cool. Looks like a real table, but it's routing table is like Cyberpunk 2077 trailer. When you see the real game, it looks like this. So ugly, all text. Because router, like I say, there are no UI one. Okay, which is why this is how it really looks like. So Now I'll show you also how you read the content here, because let's say if you have a routing table in the exam, this is the kind of table that you will get, not the kind that you see earlier, okay? Because this is the real stuff. Now, on the routing table, the very first column you will find is codes. So codes is to represent different kind of routings. Okay, so you should, yeah, no table one. You should know this routing table, in fact, it supports many kind of routes. So they have different routing protocols, okay? So routing protocols is like your choice. You can have a link state protocol, or you can have a distance vector protocol. So in this world on the internet this day, there are only two main kind of routing protocol. You are either a link state or a distance vector. So it's like you are either a Android fanboy or iOS fanboy. Only two kind of people. Okay, routing is the same. Now, of course, for different kind of algorithms, there are different examples. Like OSPF is one of an example. These are the algorithm names. Or you have RPV1, RPV2. Okay. Now, in DataCom, it is not in your scope for you to learn like how they are different from each other. If you want to, there are also in the previous video, I have one session where I explain how they are different, but that's really optional. So what you really need to know is that in the internet, there are many different routing protocols, okay? And they all work in like somewhat different way. Okay, now for routers to identify what protocol that you're running right now, you will have to look at this thing called codes. So if you see a C, it means a directly connected. If you see R, it means an RIP protocol. So for you to get the real, the full name, you can look at the table here. C means directly connected. If you see S, then you know it's a static route. If you see R, then you know it's an RIP route. So it's a distance vector route, and it is a dynamic routing. Okay, so RIPV1 is part of our scope. So maybe I should make this clearer. You have static routing and dynamic routing. Okay, now for dynamic routing, this all is only applied for dynamic routing. You have many ways to do that. And these are some examples. Now, again, this RPV1 is part of our DataCom scope. So by the end of this class, you should be able to configure a RIPV1 route. Okay, if you cannot, then in the lab test, you are the one who will be RIP. But yeah, I don't know why they name this kind of, give this kind of name to the route. If I'm a Chinese, I won't use this kind of route because I'm very particular about feng shui. Okay, so yeah, the second part here. Look at the routing table again. These are all the network ID, network address that you see here. In the table, you see here, this thing here. Okay, in the real routing table, it looks like this. Okay. Now, then you have the third one is called the next hop IP. So if you look at the last example here, it's a next hop IP. So this purple color one. And then now you see the orange color one. These are all the exit interface that we learned earlier. So there are three things here that I think is what exactly what we seen earlier. So again, you will notice something like, why not all the routes have a next hop? So like I said earlier, if it is directly connected, you don't have a next hop because you yourself is the router who will take care of the packet. So you see, if it is directly connected, which is a C here, you do not have this next hop because you're already directly connected. Okay, so directly connected is like this. If you have a router, I connect two cables, I build two networks. Immediately, without you needing to do anything, these two networks will show up in the routing table. And you will see they have this code called CNC, which represent directly connected. So if you have 10 networks directly connect to this router, you will have 10 C appear in the routing table. This one is by default automatic one. The router will auto-detect, so you don't have to key in anything or any command for this to show up. But for other things like RIP or any other routes which are not directly connected like this, then yes, we have to configure for this particular route. Okay, so this is a routing table and how it looks like, what we have in the routing table. Now, I want you to take note on this thing called administrative distance. Okay, this is just the last part of the theory, and once we are done, then we can start to configure. I think that's what everybody's waiting for. Okay, so this is called an admin distance, and why we have this number. Okay, now, this is because sometimes, I mean like most of the time, we have a backup path, like what I said earlier. So let's say now, if I go from Gamba to IKEA, Damansara, okay, I hope IKEA watch this video and then sponsor my channel. But yeah, anyway, let's hope they saw this channel. Okay, now you see, I can go, for me to go there, I can go to ETS and then go to MRT and then I reach IKEA. Okay, or I can go from Gampa and then I drive the highway, so I exit Rawang Toh or exit Tapato and then I go to exit Damansara Toh and then I reach IKEA. Okay, now you see the source and destination is the same. Source and destination is the same. So this means that I have more than one path to go to the same destination network. So in context of computer network, it is like this. I can have one route, which can be an RIP route. Then it goes to 192.168.1.0/24. Now this is the network address, and I'm going here using an IPv4 route. Okay, I can also have another route, let's say O. O is for OSPF. Then I also go to the same network because you see the ID is the same. Now, of course, you have wire something, something. Okay, now that is not important here. What is important is we find that there are two paths. Path number one, path number two, to the same place. Now, in this case, for the router, it becomes a bit confusing because now the router have another job. Which one should I take? Should I take this one or should I take this one? Or should I just random it? Or should I just like, okay, I take one time I use this one and then the second round I use this one just to look balanced then. So how does router really choose? Okay, now this one goes back to this thing called admin distance. Okay, this guy asked me to walk to IKEA so that I can buy one more curry puff with the money I save. Okay, now here, I want you to Google this thing. Let's Google this thing. Okay, you go to Google now, and then you type. I want to learn your meme, so I Google this. Okay, now type this Cisco admin distance. Admin distance. Okay, like this, okay? Then you will have this slide. This is this slide is from Cisco official support website. You go inside, okay? Then you scroll down, you'll see this table. Now this table is the admin distance table. Now this table is the same for every Cisco router that you buy. Okay. Now please don't distract me. I'm trying to be professional here. Okay, now you see every routes, what you see here on the left, these are different routes. And then on the right, this number. This number represents admin distance. So this is how router choose. Every time I have more than two routes to the same place, I will pick the route with the smaller number, smaller admin distance. So over here, as you can see, there are precedence here. This one is the most important, followed by static route, followed by EIGRP, all these things, because their number is smaller. So again, you will pick the one with smaller routes. Okay, so next. Based on our example here, if I have these two paths here, one is R and one is O, which one will it choose? So now I will have to find out what is the default admin distance value. So here, R is 120. So this is 120. Okay, so I know this is 120. AD is 120. Okay, next, I find O. O is OSPF. This one is O. Is 110. So here I know this is 110. Alright, Now, based on this, I can already tell the router will definitely take this path because this path has the smallest admin distance value. So this is how router choose. And yeah, correct, Chiu-Min, you're correct. And that is why in the routing table, you always have this value here. This is for the router to choose which one if I have more than one way to go. Alright, so this is a routing table. Now, if you want to learn more, you can always come and read the descriptions here. But if you know what I'm telling you here, then you're more, it's more than enough. Alright. Okay, now, next, I will show you two more examples on how to find next hop. In case some people already give up earlier, now come back and pick up. If you give up earlier, now you want to pick up here. Okay, and then we will start to configure router. So in this example, I have quite a complex network and I want to know what is the next hop router IP. So I hide myself again. Okay. Maybe I will have family. Yeah, I have family. All the people who like my video is my family. Okay, in order to for router 0 to go to network 2, okay, so you see here. Now we have a source and a destination. The source is 190.1.1.0. I'm trying to go to 193.200.30.0. Okay, now look at this diagram here. We will first find out where is which network. So orange color is 1.1.0, is here 1.1.0. 200.30.0 is here. Okay. Now the question is for you to go from the orange one to the green color one, the network, which one is the next hop router and what is the next hop IP? So here you see the packet will go like this, go to this router, go here, go here, go here, and go to router 3. So this is my own router. My own router is not next hop unless it's directly connected. So in this case, it's not a directly connected. So the next hop IP or next router is this router, the next router. Okay. So now I find out what is the next hop router already. I zoom in and then, okay, you can only zoom in if you have an iPad. So go and get an iPad. So here I got two interfaces. Which one should I choose as the next hop IP? You want to choose this one because this is the interface that is closer to your original router, not the one on the inside. So in this example here, this IP is the next hop IP, 200.1.1.4. That is how I find out. Okay, now one more example. Okay, now, data from 200.30.0, you want to go to 10.10.0. So let's find out where I went. Okay, so here, 200.30.0 is here, orange color one. Trying to go to 10.10.0, so here. Okay, now, once we find out this one, the next is we see how the packets travel. So it starts here, go to router 3. Goes here, go to router 1, and finally it reached the destination. So here, this is the next router. Okay, let's zoom in and then find which is the interface. So here I have two options, this one and this one. Which one should you take? You will take this one because this is the interface on router 1 that is closest to the original router. So here, this is my next hop IP, 200.1.1.2. Okay, now the answer is 200.1.1.2. This is the next hop IP. Okay, now if you are clear with this example, now I think we are ready. We get all the things we need to fight the boss. Now we will go to the boss fight. Okay, so from here onwards, It will just be a demo. Now I'm going to show you in using a packet tracer example how I configure a static routing and also a dynamic routing. But this packet will be made available for you after the stream. Okay, the one that you get right now is not compatible with the versions that you have. So just be patient and listen. Look at this demo first. After the class, then only you try this out on your own. Alright? So here I have a very simple network topology. And we want to first learn how to set a static routing. Okay, now, first thing you should know. A static routing, now it is not a question of should I set a static route or dynamic route. The questions will tell you immediately whether you want to do a static routing or a dynamic routing. Okay? So, first thing, you have to know how many networks we have here. And this one is the same example earlier. So now I have one network here. I have the second network here on the right. Oops, my same color. Now I'm teaching you how to put color. In DataCom, we also have painting class. Where is my thing? This is not user friendly. How to draw? Why white color? Why after I speak so long, it become white color? Hold on, huh? I must get this color right. Okay. Still white color. Oh, I didn't select the shape. Oh, okay. This time should be pink. Ah, now it's pink color already. Okay, okay. They have to make this to be user friendly for all people. Like in my phone, I also set the brightness to the highest before I can see anything. This is not user friendly for all people. Okay, so now I got two networks. Actually, I have one more here. In the middle one, but that is not important. I just highlight this one for it to be technically correct. Okay, you have another network here, so in fact, we have three networks here. You don't laugh at me now because you are in year one. I tell you, once you come to FICT in 3 years, you will look like me already, and your hairline will go from here to here. So that is why I say you have to name every piece of your hair, Jane and Jessica or whatever, so you know who leave you today. Okay, now come back to this one here. We have three networks. Now what I want to do is I will configure a static route, and this static route will connect a PC here, this PC here, and they allow the PC here to talk to the PC here. So after we configure, left side can talk to the right side. Now before I configure, you see there is no way I can ping. Okay, for example, now I will use PC0. Okay, I try to ping from using PC0 to PC2. Okay, so the way we do it, like as usual, you go to command prompt and you try to ping to the destination IP. So PC2 is 2.1, you ping and then you see it's unreachable. That is because we have two or more routers and they are not directly connected, but we have not set routing. So now we set routing. Okay, now set static route is two-way. That is one thing you should understand. Because static route is like this. Static route is a two-way traffic. Means that if you have a way to go from yellow color, go to pink color, you also need them to be able to come back from pink color to yellow color. Okay, now if you set only one direction, then later you will see you still cannot ping one. Because let's say if I set one way, the packet can go from here to here, come here, but he cannot go back. So it's still unreachable. So again, static route is always two-way. Like you buy ticket, you always buy two-way ticket one. Who buy one-way ticket? I don't know. Okay, so now, next thing, if you understand this concept, we look at the command, okay? The command is only three parameters. So you use the command IP route followed by the network address. Now this network address is the destination network address followed by the destination network mask. Okay, so it's 255.255 dot something depending on the network mask. And then the last parameter is the next hop IP, which is what we spent so much time to learn earlier, because we need that thing to be here. This is how we set a static route. Okay, so if you want to refer to the lab manual also, the lecture slide also can, but now I'll just straight away do the demo for you. Okay, so before you can configure any routes, you need to know the network ID. From here, based on what we learned earlier, I can know the network ID for yellow color is 192.168.1.0/24. Okay, I won't show you the calculations anymore because by now you should be like, I get it. Okay, so the next part here, 192.168.2.0. So these are the network ID for both of these network. All right, now after this one, I will need to know the next hop also. In a while, I'll show you. So now let's try to write our first static route. Okay, so in this case, you need to write two static routes. Okay, the first route is from yellow network go to pink network. The second route is from pink network go to yellow network. So again, it's two-way. So I will do the first route first, okay? 100 Jessica leave you today. Maybe next stream I will show you my shampoo that I use. Then you can use hour 25 to get 25% off for that shampoo. Okay, so let's do for this one first. First route, yellow to pink. So for me to set here, I go to router 0. Okay, I will set this on router 0 because this is my router. I cannot go to other people's router and then I set router 1. I cannot even access my. Okay, so I set for router 0 here. So go into router 0, go to the CLI, and this is where you can set. Now I won't go through the router basics here. I assume everyone here is already a pro after you go to your lab 2. If you are not, then in a while I will also upload my lab 2 video. If you think you need, then you should watch that video also. Okay. Now, just a reminder, because I get some messages from some of you, I don't know whether you're from here, saying that quiz 1, some of the thing is not covered. Now, it could be that in your lab, your tutor did not tell you about certain things. Okay, now there is no right or wrong, because every tutor is different. We have everyone of us has different way of teaching, so maybe they focus on some different thing. Now, what I can tell is everything that you find in your quiz 1 is covered. There is not even one question that I have not said before. Maybe some of those questions come from your lab, which is why I always upload lab video. Okay, it's important for you to also watch the lab video if you think that you do not know what you're doing in your lab. Alright? Okay. Now, see, now I think that person is Jermaine. So I catch her already. The person who posts to you, see, is Jermaine. Okay, now let's configure this thing. So configure a static route is actually layer 3 stuff. So you go to the layer 3 now. Okay, once you see the config, then you should be able to start to configure. Now, here, IP route. Okay, this is the command here, followed by where you want to go. So here, this is where I want to go. This is the network address, destination network. So I go here, I type 192.168.2.0. Okay, the next parameter is the mask. So mask is a slash 24. 24 means 3255. So I type 255.255.255.0. Okay, now the next parameter is the next hop IP. So this is the tricky part, you have to be very careful. We find what is the next hop IP. So here, this is my route. This is the source network. I'm trying to go here, correct? So now the packet will actually, let me show you. Okay, let's find what is the next hop. From here to here. The packet will go here, go to this router, come into this router and come here. Okay, so this one here is the next hop. Correct? Because it comes to your own router and then this is the next router. Now in this router, there are two ports, this and this. So which port should be the next hop? Again, you should always take the port that is closest to your original router. So it's the one here, not this one here. So this will be the next hop IP, 10.1.1.2. Alright? So once you get the next hop IP, you can now continue to configure the command 10.1.1.2. Press enter. That's it. Okay? Now, if you want to check whether you have entered a route correctly, you go back to your level 2, where you see a hashtag sign. You use the command show IP route. This will print your routing table. And now you see I have one new route, 192.168.2.0. So, which means that now I can go to that network, and I just need to pass my data to this guy, the next router. And I trust that he will forward the data forward. Alright, so this is what we have done. Now, of course, if we just done this, it's just one way. So now we do the second way. Alright? So now I want another route from pink color back to the yellow color. Alright? So now I will now set this on router 1 here. Go in here. We do the same thing. Go to the CLI and go to the com to configure the routes. So go to level 3. Use the command IP route. Okay? So now, where am I trying to go to? From here, I go to yellow. So this yellow is the destination network, 1.0. Okay, so now I go to 192.168.1.0. Okay, now the mask is 255.255.255.0. It's like quite straightforward. Then the next hop IP. So now we have to go and see what is the next hop IP. So come back to this diagram here. This diagram is exactly the same as you see in Packet Tracer, okay? Now I'm trying to get from here to here. So the packet will go from router 1 to router 0. In this case, this is the next hop router. Okay, now we have two interfaces here. Which one that I should take? Should I take this or this? I will pick the one on the right because this one is the interface that is closest to my original router, not this one. So this is my next hop IP, 10.1.1.1. Okay, once I have this IP, I will now go back to Packet Tracer and I can now complete the command. So IP route 192.168.1.0. This is router 0. Sorry, I got the wrong router. Okay, so I already have the one earlier, so I will just now complete this one with the next hop. It is 10.1.1.1. Enter. That's it. Okay. Now, if you want to check your routing table, you can always do a show IP route. Then you can see now I have a new static route that I just configured that allowed me to go from the pink color network to the yellow color network. And I just need to pass my data to this guy here, the next router. Okay, so when you've done this, to really check whether it works, you can just now try to ping and in a while you should be able to see they can ping. Now, the first few times you'll see a request time up. And then the reply comes. Okay, this is normal. This is normal. If you directly you can get, then it's not normal. So why first few time is request time? It's because the router is still trying to figure out how to get that. Like the first time, if you are a kampong boy and then suddenly you get a job in KL, the first day you go there, you will also spend some time in the LRT station. Which path should I take? Which train should I take? Okay, so this is router trying to figure out for the first time. But eventually, if you try to ping again, then you'll get all of them to be successful ping. Okay, so this is how I set static route to go from here to here. But remember, it's both ways. Okay, now I'll show you the next example on dynamic routing. Because you can see that, okay, now this is great, this is great. If it is only two routers, but if I have many routers, then most of the time I will spend to find what is the next hop. It's a lot of time, wasting time. Okay, so if you don't want to do that, you can always do a dynamic routing, and that is how you set. So you look at the next example in the slides. Okay, dynamic routing is really, really easy to set. And I will also show you one tip that I find out by accident that I don't think anyone else have shown. So yeah, if you want to make video, make sure you have some new contributions to the video. So today I'll show you how you set this dynamic routing with a trick that will speed up the setting as well. So this is the same network here. Now look at this router. When you set dynamic routing, it goes by router. So if you have two routers, you need to set two times. If you have three routers, you have to set three times. 10 router, 10 times. Okay, now for every router, I just need to know what is the network that is directly connected to me. So if I take router 0 as example, I have one on the green color one. This is the first network here. Okay, this is one network here. 168.1.0. Then I have another one in orange color on the right. So this is for router 0. 10.1.1.0. Two network. So when I configure an RIPv1 route, you see the command that you use is router RIP. This is to tell router you want to start configuring for RIP. And then you use the keyword network, followed by the network address of the network that is directly connected to you. So you see 1.0 here, and then 10.1.1.0 is here. So it's really, really easy. In fact, you don't even have to know like, okay, what about other routers? How many routers do I have more in the topology, or how complex is the network architecture is? Because I really don't care. I only care one thing. What are the network that is connected to me? And once you do this, later on, all this info will go into routing table. Remember just now I showed you routing table? So all this info will be in routing table, and then the router will exchange with each other, and they will learn, okay, where is this network, where is that network? Okay, that is not in the scope. So in for your scope, you just need to know how do we set for this. Now, one more example before I go to packet tracer. Let's look at router 1. Okay, router 1 is here. For router 1, I have one network yellow color, and then the other one blue color that is directly connected. And we also know the network ID is 168.2.0 and then 10.1.1.0. So this is the same one. So these are the two networks. So you see, for me to configure these routes, I just need to use the keyword network followed by the network ID here. It's so easy. So straightforward, like something Apple design. Okay, now of course it couldn't be more easier, like if you have Siri. Cisco don't have Siri, so you cannot say like, hey Siri, configure a static route for me. Okay, it doesn't work like that.
This now, should be a juicy one.
If you are using Apple device right now, I think I already wake your Siri.
I'm not sure I am.
Okay, now I think he's trying to find a friend to talk. Okay, so you see. Okay.
Stop I don't it. Have an answer for that.
Stop it. Okay. Yeah, this is if you have an iPhone right now or iPad, I'm sure your Siri is already wake up. So you see, it's not even secure. I can even set an alarm for you. Hey Siri, remind me that I have a lab test on next Saturday. See?
My I don't
service,
see an app for that.
My
You'll
service
need to download
is so
one.
Good. You don't even have to. Remember, I help you to remember. But why Cisco don't have this? If Cisco have this, it's so easy. I don't even have to learn all these things. That is why I say now I help you to find RKOI. I think Sushi is RKOI. He got Apple device. He eat lunch and dinner, sushi for lunch and dinner. And he only eat the topping, he throw away the rice. So rich. Okay, now let me configure packet tracer. Let me show you. Okay, so now this network here, I just need 5 more minutes from you. 5 more minutes, that's it. And the default route you can learn in the lab. I think the tutor will explain default route for you. Okay. So now this network here, we already have a working static route. if I set dynamic route, this will not work for dynamic route because static route is more important than a dynamic route. Static route is always the first choice. Okay, so what I need to do is I have to remove dynamic the static route first. Okay, how I remove? Okay, you see, now I have the routes that I configured earlier. This is the route. To remove a static route, you just need to go to the front of the command and you add a no keyword in front. Press enter. That is it. So easy. Then you see, now if I show IP route, the static route has been cleared. Now, of course, I will have to repeat this for the next router one. So now I go back to router one. I am going to remove this line first before I start to do the IP route. So go to level three. Can press the up arrow key to find your original command. Go to the front of the command, add the no keyword, enter, and then the route should has already been removed. Okay, now next I will set for router 0 the RIP V1 route. So now I go into router 0, I will show you a trick. Now we know that router RIP is the keyword. Okay, and then you need to only put in the network that is directly connected. Now, if the network, if the router is very confusing, like a big router that is connected to many networks, again, it will still be confusing. But that's a trick. You don't really have to look at the diagram. Because remember, if you do a show router, show routing table, show IP route, it already tells you all the network that's directly connected. So this is the trick. You don't have to go to the diagram and then you find, okay, this network, that network, because here, I already show you. This is the network, 10.1.1.0. This is the network, 1.0. Okay, so for me to set is very easy now. I do router RIP, sorry, go to level 3 first. Okay, network, followed by, I just key in this IP here because this one already show me the directly connected network. Okay, you see in RIPv1, I don't have to type any mask because RIPv1 is a classless protocol, so we don't worry about the mask. Okay, now you see here, this is the second one, so now I'll type .168.1.0, exit. That's it, just a few lines, and then I think my coffee machine is already looking at me. Okay, after this I'll celebrate. I work for 2 hours, I will celebrate for 1 day. Okay, now next I do the same for router 1. Now you have to do for both sides first before you can see anything show up in the routing table. Because this is a dynamic routing, so they somehow both sides have to work before they can start to exchange the table. Okay, so now I already have the network that is directly connected. I use router RIP. Okay, then network followed by this one here. The first network is 10.1.1.0 that is directly connected. The second one is 192.168.2.0, exit. So you see, this is the trick here. If you have this question in the exam, do show IP route to get the routing table first, then you just write directly from here. Instead of you go to look at the picture and then you try to find one by one. Okay, that's really time consuming. So once you have this, in a while, I'm very sure the router is starting to talk to each other now and here. They are whispering, so let's see whether they have a new route. Yeah, so you see here, we got it. This is the new route, and this is the RIP route, which means that now the router will be able to go from left to right and right to left because they already exchanged the routing table. You can also do this on router one's router zero side. You see now, I have one RIP route. On router zero, I can get to 2.0 network, which is this network here. And it will be sent. Wait a minute. Why do I have to log in? Okay. Then I just have to send it here. Send it here. This IP here. Okay. I hope you can still see the screen. Someone logged in my account. Every day I get hacked by different people. Okay, so yeah, that is dynamic route. To show you whether it really works, I will now try to ping using PC0. So I go back to PC0 now, I ping to 2.1, you see, now I get a reply. So they will all work the same. Static route and dynamic route, they work the same. They allow you to get to a remote network. The difference is the way you configure them and whether you should choose a static route or a dynamic route depending on what I explained earlier. Alright, now, is default route still in use? Yes, default route is in use in every routers. To learn more about default route, I won't cover in the lecture class, so you will learn more about default routing in your lab 3, which is, I think, next week. Yeah, next week. And that will be in exercise 3, if I'm correct. Okay, so today, let's wrap this up. What we have learned so far is we have talked about a new concept on network routing. We already know why you want to do network routing and when you should do network routing. It's not always, but you only do that if you have two or more routers and then you want to go to a network that is far away from your current network. Okay, we call that a remote network. Then we also talk about how to set a static route and dynamic route. So depending on which one you like, okay? Now, of course, static route is good if you have a simple network, but it's fixed. That means it doesn't change as the topology change. So, like, you also don't want to tattoo your boyfriend name in your arm, right? Because what if you change boyfriend suddenly? So you don't want to tattoo your boyfriend name. Static route is like tattoo your boyfriend name. So a better way is you do a dynamic routing, okay? Now, if you're okay with everything that we learned today, I think that's all that I want to show you. Thank you for joining me today. I see you on the next one, same time next week on week 7. Bye-bye.